Hello from the Forcetronics YouTube channel and welcome to how to build a lithium ion and USB power design with built-in charging. And this will be part one in a four-part series. Before I get started, I'll just mention, check out Forcetronics.com for information on our design, manufacturing, and consulting services for commercial projects. And if you like what you see here, hit the thumbs up on the video. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. All right, let's get started. So here's a diagram of what we're going to design here, and I'm going to take you step by step through everything from component selection to how we're going to spec and pick the values of our components to the schematic layout and to the PCB layout. And then finally at the end, I'll share a BOM with all the parts you need if you want to build this same circuit. So the idea is we're going to have two power sources for this circuit. We're going to have a USB input for 5 volts, or you can just have any 5-volt input. And then we're also going to have a lithium ion battery cell input. And the idea is we'll have a circuit that allows these two power sources to be switched between each other easily. And then also we'll have a switching voltage regulator that'll take those input power sources and turn them into a regulated 5-volt out to power a load. You know, that load could be, you know, an ESP32 or some other microcontroller, LEDs, whatever you want to do. And then also we'll have a battery charging circuit that when we have, you know, a USB or 5-volt input and our lithium ion battery cell is not fully charged, the charging circuit will automatically charge it for us. So here's a list of what we're going to cover. And like I said, the goal here is I'm going to take you step by step through my process that I use for designing a circuit like this. And at the end, we'll look at the finished product. So in this first video, I'm just going to cover the basics of lithium ion or lithium polymer battery cells. And throughout this video, I'm just going to use lithium ion, but you could also use lithium polymer. They're pretty much interchangeable. And then I'm also going to cover in this video voltage regulator basics, because when you're working with battery power, you need your power to be used efficiently, and choosing the right voltage regulator is very important when you have a battery power design. So in part one, that's all I'm going to cover. If you're already familiar with lithium ion cells and you're already familiar with voltage regulators and things like that, then maybe you just skip to part two. I'm going to publish both part one and part two at the same time. In part two and three, I'm going to talk about the circuit design, first for the voltage regulator circuit, which is going to be the more complex circuit, and then in part three for the battery charging and power isolation circuits. Then we're going to get into the PCB layout for the circuit design. Once again, for the switching voltage regulator, PCB layout is very important. Then in part four, we're also going to look at some demos and some real-world circuit measurements of our finished product, and then also include a BOM in the final video. Okay, let's start with the lithium ion or lithium polymer battery cell basics. So lithium ion, I think everybody knows this, they're the best energy density battery cell or multiple cell battery compared to anything else. And I've used nickel metal hydride, which is a really a rugged battery, but compared to lithium ion, as far as its cycles and its energy density, it doesn't compare. And we all know lithium ion is used from everything from electric cars to your cell phone. Lithium ion batteries, though, they're typically spec'd with their average voltage and their current capacity. And here's an example. I provide a part number that I'll use for a demo later. This is sort of a real small lithium ion cell. You could obviously use a bigger one. But this one, for example, specs a 3.7 voltage for the battery, which is pretty common for a single lithium ion cell. And then it has a 0.27 amp hour rating or 270 milliamp hours. And so what that means is if you use this battery cell, you should be able to get 270 milliamps over an hour before the battery is fully discharged. But also the average voltage for a lithium ion battery or any battery is often deceiving. Really, the battery has a voltage range that is pretty wide. And whenever you're using the battery, that voltage range or the voltage value that it's outputting is constantly changing. That's what makes batteries tough to deal with. You can't just directly hook them up to your design or your microcontroller because of that constantly changing voltage. And for a lithium ion cell, typically that voltage range is about 4.2 volts or 4.1 volts to about 2.5 volts. It just depends how long you want to discharge it down. For lithium ions, the lower you charge it or the lower you use it or lower you discharge it, I should say, the lower life you get out of it. And then with lithium ion, you don't want to discharge it past about 1.7 volts or 1.6 volts. In fact, a lot of lithium ion cells actually will have a small protection circuit that prevents you from doing that. And this part number of this battery, the ASR00007, has that in there. So you can't discharge it past 1.7 volts. And that's basically the downside of lithium ion. Great energy density, great cycle count, but if you over discharge them or overcharge them, they can heat up, they can explode and cause issues like that. So that's the main downside. Here I have a chart from a Battery University website. I borrowed it. And if you want to learn more about lithium ion and lithium polymer battery cells, check out Battery University. But I don't want to go into detail of this chart, but the whole point of this chart is showing you that this is showing a curve for different cell rates for discharging them. And you can see the voltage is constantly changing and it's not linear, right? So you can't really predict what the voltage is going to be, which is important for how you charge the battery and also for your voltage regulator that has to take this changing voltage and turn it into a constant regulated voltage. One last thing I'll mention is whenever you see a charge rate or discharge rate with a C, like for instance, this green one in 1C, that basically means you're discharging it at the rate of its amp hour rating. So if this chart was for this model battery, the green line would represent a discharge rate of 270 milliamps. So it should take an hour to discharge. And notice too, this graph says 3 volts is the end of discharge. I typically use 2.5, but you can see that varies and that affects the life of the battery. And also how fast you discharge the battery and how fast you charge it also affects it. The slower you discharge, the slower you charge, you typically get longer life. The faster you charge it, you typically don't get as long life out of the battery cell. And last thing I'll show you is just a charging curve, right? Because this is what our charging circuit's gonna have to handle. So I want you to remember, you know, the fact that a lithium ion cell doesn't have a constant voltage. Its voltage is constantly changing and it has a wide range from 4.2 to about 2.5. When you charge it, it's not a simple charge either, right? This example shows a charge rate of 1 amp, basically when you charge it using a constant current source, typically. And then you can see that rate falls off. The voltage remains real steady, so you can't use voltage necessarily at this point as a way to tell if it's charged or not. So it's sort of a combination of monitoring the current and the voltage. But don't worry, we're going to use an IC in our circuit that's going to handle this for us. Next thing I want to talk about is voltage converters or voltage regulators. A lot of times you hear them said different ways, but there's two main types of voltage regulators or voltage converters, and that's linear and switching, and they both have their pros and cons. So linear voltage regulators, they're low noise, they're real easy to implement, you only need a couple components with them, and they're typically low cost. The problem with linear regulators though is poor efficiency, and they can only step down voltages. The input voltage needs to be higher than the output voltage. So that's not gonna work for our example, right? Because we wanna have a 5 volt output, but a lithium ion cell doesn't go up to 5 volts. So we need a way to boost the voltage, right? And so that's where switching regulators come in, switching voltage regulators. Switching voltage regulators are great because they have good efficiency, which is important for batteries, right? We want to get as much power as we can out of the battery, so we want good efficiency. But also switching regulators can boost or buck or boost and buck. And what boost means is the input voltage is lower than the output voltage, and buck means the input voltage is higher than the output voltage. And then they also make switching regulators that can do both boost and buck. In our design, we're going to use a boost regulator, and we'll go over a tutorial of what a boost regulator is and sort of the theory of how it works. The downside to switching regulators are they're noisy, they're tougher to design and implement, as we're going to see. You got to pay real close attention to component selection. There's some math often when you're calculating what components you need, which we'll go through. And then also PCB layout is critical for switching regulators compared to linear regulators. And they're typically higher cost just because you need more components. Now, this is sort of saying something I already said, but one thing I just want to point out is why we don't want to use linear regulators. And one thing that sort of annoys me is, you know, I'm a big Arduino fan and I talk about Arduino and I have training videos on Arduino. If you look at your Arduino board, they're typically always going to have linear regulators. And what sometimes annoys me, if you look at some of those, I don't know if it's the Maker 1000s or some of the other third-party boards, a lot of them will have a lithium ion cell connection so you can power your Arduino board with a battery. And they'll also have a charging circuit on it too, which is great. The problem is at least for the boards I've seen, they have linear regulators. Well, the problem with linear regulators is let's say you're trying to get First of all, you couldn't get a 5-volt bus, but let's say you were trying to get a 3.3-volt bus from a linear regulator using a battery as the power source. Well, first of all, for that linear regulator, it can't step up voltages, it can only step them down. And you have to have a higher voltage input than you get on the output. So for a linear regulator, you have a really good one. Maybe you can use 3.4 volts, but often you got to use 3.5 or 3.6 volts as an input, the minimum input to achieve 3.3 volt output. Well, if you have a lithium ion battery and it has a usable voltage range of 4.2 volts to 2.5 volts, you're only going to get like half of the capacity out of the battery, if that. That's why you really got to use switching voltage converters or regulators, whether you need 3.3 volts, whether you need 1.8 volts, or whether you need 5 volts. You're just going to get better efficiency out of that battery when you use a switching regulator. Okay, so what I want to cover next is an example or a crash course on a boost switching regulator. Now, there's more than one type of switching regulator. I mentioned the buck and the boost, and then you have the combination. Here we're going to use a boost because we need to boost our voltage up to 5 volts from the battery. And I'm not going to get into the math here, so I'm just going to kind of step through this. But the main thing with a switching regulator is the fact that you're going to have a switching device. It's going to be pulse width modulated controlled, and you're going to have inductors and capacitors because those are energy storage devices. So a switching regulator is based off of these energy storing devices and using them in a way to generate a DC voltage that's stable based on load changes. So you might kind of say, looking at this circuit, be like, how is this going to create a DC voltage? Well, let me talk about it. And remember, when I talk about this stuff, we're talking about stuff that's happening very fast, you know, milliseconds, microseconds type stuff. So let's start off with the initial condition that our voltage source, which could be a USB input or it could be our battery, let's start off with that, the initial condition that our voltage source is connected and on, and our capacitor is charged to the voltage of the voltage source minus this diode drop. The next step would be we want to close the MOSFET. So when I say close the MOSFET is this device right here. And I'm assuming people listening have a basic understanding of MOSFETs, capacitors, inductors, things like that, diodes. For step one, we want to close, or I should say step two, we want to close the MOSFET. And this creates basically a short. So we have our voltage source connected to the inductor through this. Now, you might say over time, this is just a short, but remember, initially, when we close this diode, this inductor actually presents a very high impedance to this voltage source. The entire voltage source is dropped across the inductor. And I'm putting in equations for inductor and capacitor just for those who are curious. But the idea is then the magnetic field of the inductor starts to build up, store energy. An inductor is more of a current device. It tries to resist changes in current, where the capacitor tries to resist changes in voltage. And the idea is, in a short amount of time, this inductor first is a high impedance, but as its magnetic fields, current starts to flow through it, right? Well, then next, we have a signal that comes in that then opens our switch or our MOSFET. So now it's high impedance. So now our inductor is charged up or has a magnetic field of stored current, and this path is no longer there. So now it's going to discharge through these paths through the diode. So notice the voltage switches, right? So that's why we have that negative right here. So first, when it was building its magnetic field, it was plus minus, now it's minus plus. So it almost acts like a current pump or a current source to push current through the diode. Of course, we're gonna get a drop across the diode into the capacitor. And if the capacitor is rated for the right voltage, the voltage of the capacitor will start to raise higher than the initial charge from the voltage source. Also, you're gonna get current flowing into the load, right? So now all of a sudden we get a higher voltage building here. Once it reaches the voltage we want, our switching device again is going to close and it's going to repeat the cycle. Now remember, this is going to happen very quick. Now if we have a constant load, we just need a steady clock signal, a steady square wave signal with some type of open and close ratio that matches the load's current consumption. But the idea is the load changes. So we use a pulse width modulated signal that's dynamically changing to change the open and close time to pump the right amount of current to maintain that voltage level here at 5 volts for our example. As I mentioned down here, I keep talking about a pulse width modulated signal. So what's not shown here is in a real voltage regulator, boost regulator, we'll also have a feedback circuit that's monitoring the voltage and feeding it back into our circuit to some type of comparator circuit that's also monitoring the input voltage, which could be changing as well. So we have the input, the output, and that value is compared, and then that's going to dynamically change the pulse width modulated rate, right? Because our load could be changing dynamically as well. So we want to maintain a constant voltage. Now, one of the things I said of the downside of a switching regulator is the fact that they are noisy, right? So this capacitor helps smooth out the DC and make it a sort of a constant, but it's not going to be perfect. You're going to have a little noise on there, and you can put some things on the output to help smooth out that noise, but it's never going to be as clean as a linear regulator. So that is the downside of the boost switching regulator. But what I want you to do is remember this for part two, because we're going to jump into the switching regulator we're going to use. And you know, you could build your own switching regulator with all these little parts, but we're going to use an off-the-shelf IC that allows, that handles the MOSFET, that handles the comparator, the feedback, as well as deciding the pulse width modulated signal, as well as handles the diode. We just need to size the inductor, the capacitor, and some other supporting components. Remember, this is just a real simple diagram. Okay, before I close, I just wanted to quick show also a linear regulator. There's more than one way to design a linear regulator, but the idea here is the linear regulator, if this is our input voltage and this is our load, the linear regulator works by using a transistor or a MOSFET almost as a variable resistor. So as the load changes, this op amp uses Q1 in its nonlinear zone to basically burn off some of that voltage to get the right voltage here. And it just dissipates that power as heat. That's why it's not as efficient as a switching regulator. But of course, since we don't have switching devices in here, we don't have that noise. We have a nice smooth DC output. Okay, that's it for part one of how to build a lithium ion and USB powered design with built-in charging. In part two, we're going to jump right into the boost voltage regulator circuit design. We're going to take a look at the IC we're going to use, why we're going to use that regulator IC, how we're going to spec the surrounding components for it, how we're going to put that together, and then we'll go from there. If you have any questions or you think I missed anything, please use the comment section. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you back for part two.